was just going to ask that. So you do have spares. You can hit me up after church, all right? I'm there. All right. So anybody else needs cookies, you're second in line behind me. I'm glad that you all are here. We are in Lent, as you know. And so we are preparing ourselves, hopefully, spiritually speaking, practically speaking, trying to be introspective and examining our lives and asking God to help us make corrections, help us to be more grateful for what we have, and help us to be more diligent in making some changes. That's what Lent, at least in my opinion, is all about. And so today we're going to talk about some of those things, but as we begin our worship service, may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
As we begin to pray, I just want to mention, Susie mentioned that Susie's mom, Cindy, fell and broke her ankle. So we want to remember her in our prayers. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
I also want to mention Connie Connolly. We haven't heard anything recently about her status, but she's struggling with the end of life issues. And so let's remember her. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Last week also we prayed for Diane Jones. We did hear from her daughter that Diane is just closing her eyes and not opening it much at all. So even though we were planning a 90th birthday for her, I'm going to take that blank quilt that Rebecca Senkowitz had made. And if you can just bless that as we pray, I'll take it to her. God, in your mercy. I also want to mention a good friend of mine, Perry Jones, had a tragic thing happen for his family. His older son was found unconscious, 40 years old. So he has suffered some brain injury. So let's remember that family in our prayers. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Do you have any other prayer requests?
This is our next door neighbor. He's 63 years old. He's just been diagnosed with rapid onset dementia. And so he and his wife are, you know, going to have to move and a lot of things. So his name is Dan. Her name is Kim.
God, in your mercy. Let us pray. Let us seek and find God's presence in our midst. Call upon God while the Holy One is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to our God and receive pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says God. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Look upon us with your grace and love, O God, as we gather together on this third Lenten Sunday. On this Sunday, when we meditate on second chances and try to understand powerful verses in the scripture about the grace of God, bless us. As we read in John's Gospel, out of God's fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. The heart to forgive again and again is a virtue that we all have trouble practicing. But knowing how we are forgiven and given chance to rectify our lives successfully make us humble and grateful on a day like this. Help us to cleanse ourselves and come before you to be in your loving presence. On a day when we hear more damaging and tragic ways Ukraine is being attacked, we despise the evil behind it, and we on our own make decisions to help the victims of this war crime. May we learn to cling to the goodness that we see and how we can reach out to bless the lives of others. Keep us away from relinquishing our true nature as we see the evil around us. May we be true as we bear fruit that God has been waiting to see in our lives. Today we pray for all who have found it difficult to pull themselves up by their bootstraps. We realize some of them do not have boots or bootstraps. Yet we judge them without handing them a tool to work with to redeem themselves. We remember people who are addicted to drugs and alcohol, people who suffer from chronic medical and mental illnesses, people who have lost hope and do not ever get a second chance. Hear the prayers that we raise as we remember people in our immediate circles hurting in some ways. Comfort all who mourn. Give hope and inspiration for those who have lost their sense of direction. Hear our spoken prayers as well as our silent prayers as we pray as Jesus taught us. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The scripture reading for today is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, starting at verse 6. Listen now for the word of God. Then Jesus told them this parable. There was once a man who had a fig tree growing in his vineyard. He went looking for figs on it, but found none. So he said to his gardener, "Look, for 3 years I've been coming here looking for figs on this fig tree, and I haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it go on using up the soil?" But the gardener answered, "Leave it alone, sir, just one more year. I'll dig around it and put in some fertilizer. Then if the tree bears figs next year, so much the better. If not, then you can have it cut down." The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
However, this piece is called Prayer. It's, the text is written by Langston Hughes, and it's from a collection of poems called Genius Child. And he attributes this as the prayer Christ could have prayed at Gethsemane. Thank you.
We thank you for this day, O God, and it is a day that you have given to us. Make us aware of who we are, who you are, and whose presence we are in. I pray that through the power of the Holy Spirit, that the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. I have, by way of introduction, it's really not an introduction, but I'll try to segue it into the sermon as best. I've been thinking a lot, as you have, about this war in Ukraine and about how horrible it is, inhumane, senseless. The wars of this world are largely waged by people who, at the top, who have little to no, at least in my estimation, little to no sense of any kind of human regard, and are interested in power, greed, money, these kinds of things, and don't think too much about the suffering that brings about. You know, whenever something like this happens, and I want you to stick with me here for a few minutes, whenever something like this happens, we turn all of our attention to it, as we should, and we think about all the suffering in Ukraine, from the human loss, from the 3 million plus refugees now who have fled the country. We should think about these things, but what about all the rest of the wars currently being waged in the world? Because there are several. Is the human suffering and injustice being waged there of any less concern than what's happening in Ukraine? Is the pain level of those who have lost loved ones in any of these wars, is it any less than anybody else in the world? I think about this sometimes. For example, let's say a major flood goes through part of the United States, and let's say it wipes out or damages severely, let's say 300 homes. And immediately we think about those folks and their loss and so forth. And as a nation, we will send a lot of aid and money and supplies and so forth. And it gets a lot of attention, as it should. But what about a person who has a house alongside a river somewhere, and that river comes up and floods that house? How much attention do we give to those people? Is their pain any less? Is their loss any less? We think about mass murders, mass shootings, and those kinds of things, but when was the last time you stopped to think about, and I read about in the paper with alarming regularity, about shootings here in Pittsburgh, people being shot and killed? Are those families who suffer those losses, is their loss any less than those who are lost in mass shootings someplace? I don't think so. You understand my point? My point is that we should absolutely be concerned about what's happening in Ukraine and giving it our full attention. We should. We have to. But let's not lose sight of the fact that humor and suffering is all around us. It can be on a huge scale. It can be on a tiny scale. When Susan lifts up the prayers in the morning, she talks about people in specific, and their pain is massive. And we need to be thinking about that. The pain in your lives. Maybe you have somebody close to you who is suffering. Maybe you have some kind of critical issue in your life that you're dealing with. Your pain is real as those who are spread out throughout the world. Does this make any sense? What I'm saying is all of these things are all around us. And as Christians, we are called, as people of all faith are called, as Christians, we are called to not only think about something out there, but to think about something around us, and to think about our own lives and how we relate to the people around us who are in some kind of pain. And this is hard work, and it requires a lot of spiritual growth on our part, a lot of awareness, and a lot of patience. And patience is what I want to talk about today. All that was by way of introduction, and now I know it's a weak segue, but bear with me. I want to talk about patience. I don't have a whole lot of patience in certain things. You know what I'm very impatient about? Anything that I have to put into the microwave. Even if it's only a minute to warm up a cup of coffee, it just seems like forever to me to wait for that bell. Anybody else? That kind of thing. Yeah. Thanksgiving dinner, for example. You get called to the table. Everybody goes in there and sits down. And good manners and graciousness teach us that nobody starts to eat until everybody is seated at the table. Now, my mother, when she was living, used to call us all to the table. We'd go in and sit down, and then she would spend the next 5 minutes rustling around out in the kitchen or whatever, and we'd be there, come on, come on, come on. I was impatient about that. When she no longer was living and no longer had that responsibility, Ramona has admirably filled their role. And she will keep us waiting for what seems to me like to be 2 hours. There are times when you're impatient, right? But this is really, I think, you know, on a grander scale, impatience can stunt our growth. Impatience can stunt our spiritual growth because we want it now. And I think this is one of the draws. I grew up in the evangelical community, as some of you did as well. I think this is actually one of the draws as to what it's all about when being saved is a one-and-done kind of thing. Whether you respond to an altar call or have such a great experience and you say, this is the time, boom, now I'm saved, now I don't have to worry about it anymore because I get to go to heaven, thank God for that. Now I'm minimalizing this, I understand it. This is it, see, I don't have to wait anymore. Not my experience. In 1989, I put together, with the assistance of a couple other people, a very large event, interestingly enough, called a Congress on Evangelism. And as part of our marketing campaign, I was invited to appear on a television show. Channel 40 was religious broadcasting. Anybody remember Channel 40?
Still is.
It still is. And the host was Russ Bixler. Does that ring a bell to anybody? Russ Bixler. And anyhow, so I went to that studio and Russ came in, introduced himself, and he said, and he had a little notebook with him, and he said, I want to know your testimony. He said, can you give me the date of your salvation? Well, you know, in that tradition, if you don't have a date and a time, it doesn't matter. See, because you got to know, right? And I said, well, I have several life experiences that I can give to you that, you know, are meaningful to me, but I can't give you a specific date as to when I've been, you know, saved. He wrestled with that. I know he was thinking, I'm not going to allow this guy to come on my set. But he allowed me to go on there, but he avoided all the questions about being saved and testimony and all those kinds of things, thankfully. Well, that's that tradition that I grew up in. I understand it. I get it. And I'm telling you that I think that some people do have that kind of experience. Maybe some of you have had. I'm not downplaying that at all. What I'm saying is, I think for me, maybe for you, I think that our spirituality, our salvation, if you will, is an ongoing process. And every day, if somebody says to me, what day were you saved? I'm going to tell them, today. Today. And if they ask me again tomorrow, I'm going to have the same question, today. You know, the Bible says, this is the day the Lord has made. Let's be grateful, be glad in it, today. Behold, this is the day of your salvation. That's really what I have to say to myself every day when I get up and look in the mirror first thing in the morning. This is the day of my salvation. See, because I'm progressing. I'm making progress. I'm understanding things more and more. Well, Jesus, I'm not sure he was talking about this, but I draw this out of the parable. That's why I told parables, little stories that have meanings, and everybody had heard the parable got a different meaning out of it, so let me tell you what my understanding of this parable is. He told this parable, this story, about a man who owned a garden or a vineyard, and it said he went into the vineyard, and he wanted to get some figs off of this tree, and there were none. And he was mad. He was angry. He was impatient. And he called his gardener and he said, "Listen, for 3 years now, I have been coming into this garden to get figs off of this tree, and I have no figs. I want you to cut it down. It's just taking up soil." Now, here's the interesting thing. You know, in my little bit of research about fig trees in the Holy Land, once you have plant a fig tree, it takes a full 3 years for that tree to mature enough so that it will begin to bear fruit. Am I right, Susan? I turned to Susan. You know, Susan has an undergraduate degree in botany. Did you know that? That's why I always turn to her to see if I'm getting this right. 3 years. And in fact, this man said this. For 3 years, I've been coming here, and I have nothing. 3 years. It's time. Boy, we're so good about that, aren't we? You're 16 years old now. It's time that you do this. You're 18 years old now. It's time. You're 21. It's time. You're 40, it's time. Sometimes I think all of us will have this experience where we think to ourselves, you know, what's wrong with me? By this time, I should have been this. By this time, I should have grown up enough or matured enough to understand this. By this time, we are impatient. Sometimes it takes a fig tree up to 6 years to begin to bear fruit. So this man was requiring something of this tree that perhaps it wasn't capable of at that point. And in our spiritual growth, the same thing applies. We may not be able to bear the fruit that we expect or that other people expect of us or that we think God expects of us, but maybe it's not our time yet. Maybe we haven't matured enough. So what happens in the meantime? We just sit back and wait and see what happens? No, it can be a painful process. Because what did the gardener say? The gardener said, well, first of all, let's give it some time. I'm going to get out my pitchfork and come out here and dig around the roots. I'm going to loosen up all the soil. You ever feel like somebody's picking at you? Feel like life is picking at you? You feel like people are just, you know, shoveling around you and so forth? What's going on here? Maybe the gardener has a pitchfork and is trying to loosen you up a little bit. You're too tight. You're too tightly wound today. You got to loosen up. You got to relax. You got to know that God is using a pitchfork to loosen up your soil so that you can receive the nutrients. Now, what nutrients are we talking about? I love this. I'm going to put some fertilizer around it. After I loosen up fertilizer. You know what they're talking about when they say fertilizer here in the New Testament, don't you? It's not something you go buy, you know, one of these big box stores. It's, how should I say this? Dung. Manure. Stinky, smelly, disgusting manure. And he piled it on around that fig tree. And when you had the feeling, it's like, life is just piling it on me, baby. Every day I get up and it's like, I'm just more and more and more of this coming my way. Maybe you should be grateful for that. Because if you're patient, you see, if you're patient, you know that this may be for your own good. That when it's all said and done, your time comes to bear some kind of fruit, and it's because you've had the patience to wait through it and to live through it and to accept the prodding and to accept the manure and to accept all of these what we think are bad things coming our way, because eventually we look back and say, today's the day of my salvation. I get it now. So my point today is this. There's pain, there's suffering all around us. There's pain and suffering inside of ourselves. It's not out there. To be sure, it may be out there. But we have enough to deal with in our own lives and in our own situations and so forth. How do we deal? presence of God and we say, God, I may not be feeling good today because life's piling it on, but I know if I get through this, I'm going to be a better person. Today is the day of your salvation. Let's pray. We thank you, God, for the lessons of the Bible. We pray today for those who are suffering in any way, shape, or form. We pray for Ukrainians. We pray for those who are suffering and through all kinds of wars across this world today. We pray for those who are sick and ill and those who mourn. We pray for our neighbors. We pray for our family members. We pray for ourselves today.